November 8th is Election Day, and for the first time in NBA history, no games will be scheduled. It's part of an effort to encourage fans, staff, and players to get out and vote in the midterms.
All right, big emphasis on staff there. Let's think about how many people can show up to the polls because they've got to work. We've got some reporting from CBS on this. So roughly 138 million Americans voted in the 2016 presidential election. Just 61.4% of the 214 million who are registered to vote, according to the US Election Assistance Commission. So let's just match up these statistics, okay? So 61% voting, according to a survey from the Society for Human Resource Management in 2018, 44% of US employers offer their work paid time off to vote, and that's an all-time high. All right, so there are a lot of people, very likely, who are not casting ballots simply because they are working. So think about how many people are employed by the NBA. I wouldn't think about this from the perspective of, you know, people can just vote before the game. Why do we have to have no games on that Tuesday? Well, there are a lot of people who I'm sure have to be at those stadiums all day long on game day. So this is huge for ensuring that workers can vote and setting a precedent. In many countries around the world, election days are national holidays. They happen on Sundays, or people have multiple days in which they can cast a ballot. The United States is a big exception when it comes to how difficult it is to vote in this country. We have another quote from the executive director of the NBA's Social Justice Coalition, who told NBC, "It's unusual. We don't usually change the schedule for an external event. Voting and election day are obviously unique and very important for our democracy." I would have to agree. But let's focus in on how difficult it is to vote in the United States. It's a racial justice issue especially. 70.9% of white voters cast ballots compared to only 58.4% of non-white voters. In the past 25 years, half of the states have changed their laws and practices to expand voting access to people with felony convictions. But despite these important reforms, 5.2 million Americans remain disenfranchised. This is 2.3% of the voting age population that simply cannot vote because they've been convicted of a felony. They've been disenfranchised and stripped of their rights. Voting purges are an often flawed process of cleaning up voter rolls by deleting names from registration lists, while updating registration lists as voters die, move, or otherwise become ineligible is necessary and important. When done irresponsibly with bad data, or when two voters are confused with the same person, the process can knock eligible voters off of the roll in mass, often with little notice. Many voters discover they're no longer listed only when they arrive at the polling place. As a result, many eligible Americans either don't vote or forced to cast provisional ballots. This is a huge problem. I have worked with a lot of voter data in the past, and really when you're trying to canvass people and get up a list of voters that you want to go knock their door, talk to them about the election coming up, it's a huge problem that suddenly they're unregistered. And they say, "When did that happen? I thought I was registered to vote." And it's because of situations like this. And the reason that this can happen is because of a Supreme Court decision back in 2013. But let's just look at what's happened since then. So over the last decade, jurisdictions have substantially increased the rate at which they purge voter rolls. Brennan Center research found that between 2014 and 2016, so after that Supreme Court decision, states removed almost 16 million voters from the rolls, a 33% increase over the period between 2006 and 2008. The increase was highest in states with a history of voting discrimination. It's also a huge problem that people have to show up with voter IDs. The voter ID laws in this country are keeping people who can't afford to get them disenfranchised, unable to vote. Overly burdensome photo ID requirements block millions of eligible American citizens from voting. As many as 11% of eligible voters do not have the kind of ID that is required by states with strict ID requirements. And that percentage is even higher among seniors, minorities, people with disabilities, low-income voters, and students. And again, from the Brennan Center reporting, many citizens find it difficult to obtain government photo IDs because the necessary documentation, such as a birth certificate, is often difficult or expensive to acquire. So I mentioned that earlier Supreme Court decision that is making all of this much more complicated in recent years. So this is reporting from Reuters. Under the Voting Rights Act of 1965, areas with a history of voting discrimination, such as requiring African American or Hispanic voters to pay a poll tax or pass a literacy test, had to first convince the US Justice Department or a federal court that any election changes they wished to make would not have a discriminatory effect. The Supreme Court struck down that portion of the law in 2013. States across the American South have closed 1,200 polling places since this Supreme Court decision. And I think the most dramatic example of the effects of this was in 2020 during the primaries in Wisconsin, when the city of Milwaukee had just 5 in-person voting sites for their Tuesday primary election day, while Madison, a city with a smaller population, had 66 sites where voters could cast their ballots. So Milwaukee's population is almost 600,000 people. Madison's population is 258,000 people. Milwaukee's population is 40% Black. Madison's is 7% Black. Milwaukee's per capita income is $24,000. Madison's is $40,000. So you can see maybe why we are encouraging the folks in Madison to vote and making it easier for them, and making it way more difficult for the folks in Milwaukee to cast their ballots. This is a huge problem. The people who have to work the most also in this case had the least options for going out and casting their ballot. The people with the least income who absolutely have to show up to work that day couldn't show up. So they need time off to vote, and the NBA is setting a good precedent. JR, I'd love to get your thoughts on that.
This is crazy. This is the thing. You went through all of that very deep, expansive informational part about how people have been disenfranchised from voting for so many years in so many different ways. By the way, once one thing is fixed, because, you know, of course, Black folks weren't allowed to vote, women weren't allowed to vote. And when those things get remedied, it just has to be re-implemented in other ways that maybe get by the radar. That's just the way this whole thing works. So of course, when the NBA, I would love to see some of the response from people who may have a problem with this. When the NBA implements a policy like this, where they give everyone off or take the day off for this particular reason, I'm trying to figure out how it could potentially be demonized. Because every time anything, when it comes to expanding voting rights or expanding the voter rolls, it gets demonized as some kind of a theft of our democracy. We literally flip reality on its head. We promote and we announce we're the shiny example on the hill. We're the country that loves voting. We're the country that empowers every citizen that's eligible to vote. We say all this stuff, and then the work that's done to go through all that to disenfranchise so many voters is a lot of work. To make sure that voter rolls are cleared, or if there's a double name, who cares if it does, if it kind of would make sense? Let's just clear it. That same kind of effort can go into keeping people on the voter rolls. You could actually, if you want to implement and put all kinds of money towards how much you care about the vote, you could make sure people get their opportunity if something is expiring, or if they move and now they discover they're in a different district. Hey, if you got car registration that's due, and you owe $245 to the Secretary of State DMV, depending on your state, they send notices, then they send the next notice, then they send you the email, then there's another notice. Hey, your car registration's about to be up, bruh. They let you know, because that's an okay process for you to come back in and make sure that they're on that kind of process. Paul Weyrich, who's, I think they coined the godfather of the conservative movement back in the 80s, he said very openly, I love playing that video. He said, I don't want more people to vote. These, you know, the weak-minded conservatives, Republicans these days, want these folks to vote. I don't want it. As more people vote, the fewer chances we have to win. Said it wide, openly, and in front of an audience. That should always live on to see the real policies of these folks who want to eliminate voting rights. Because if you're not appealing to the majority of people with your policies, you have to eliminate the number of people that are voting. It's the only way you can stay in power.
Absolutely. I can give you your answer, JR. How will they demonize this? Let's pretend to be Fox News for a second, right? First, we know how they reacted when LeBron James was talking about Colin Kaepernick taking a knee for police brutality. We know that they said LeBron James should not have an opinion on politics. He he should shut up and dribble, whatever they said. They're going to say these same people who have radical views in their politics, who want to disrespect members of their military and not stand during the national anthem, now they're encouraging all of their employees to vote. Why do they get special treatment to go out and vote when all of you have to be working and find time in your own schedules? Do they deserve to vote more than you? This is absolutely going to be
the Fox narrative. I hope that's the argument. And I hope that people are smart enough to say, hey, I have an idea. Let's not make it unfair. You should do it too. And you over there, you company should do it too. If you think this is unfair, let's make it fair and let everyone have this situation. Or if politicians want to ask it, you guys are legislators. You have a position where you can maybe make a voting holiday. We have holidays all the time. Yeah. If you care about the process of voting, then you would make sure that it's an important thing that you activate and energize your citizens to do. Yeah. We promote everywhere else, we can't promote here.
Absolutely. I don't see the Supreme Court or members of Congress doing much. I mean, we know what's happened when we've tried to make voting more accessible. We know that the Supreme Court has only gotten worse since 2013. And so again, I sound like a broken record, but the solution is to organize your workplace. Every union contract should have a provision that workers have the day off for election day. And you don't even need a union to do this. You can have all of your workers at your workplace come together and say, hey, management, this is something we want. You don't have to affiliate with like a big international union to get something done, for workers to come together and say, this is what we want. And so, yeah, this should absolutely not be something exclusive to folks at the NBA. It should be something everyone enjoys every election day, and maybe even days before election day.
For more political news breakdowns, interviews, stories of activism, and me trying my hardest to care about the occasional big celebrity news story, subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/thedamagereport. And you can ring the bell wherever it is so you don't miss anything.